Good evening. I have about 30 minutes, and it's a hard stop, because that's what the chef gave me before you have the main course, and I've been told he has some very sharp knives. What I wanted to share with you is a bit of the synthesis of 30 years of experience in finance and technology, and I will put the emphasis a bit on technology, less finance. And I wanted to lay out a number of broad implications that I see. Not because I think what I think is right, but because I think I will ask some questions that makes you think. And that's quite important as you enter into a conference like this. Now, you might immediately think, what is this funny word, digitalias? It's a contraction of two words, digital and alias. Digital, because we all live in areas of digital disruption and so on. You heard about Amazon and Google, and I'll dwell a bit on that. And alias, because alias means a different word for something that actually is the same, or it's like an alibi. And my key point here is that the digital disruption that is brought to us and that is meandering everywhere is basically the product of dramatic technological innovation. And my second key point is it has some quite profound consequences. Now, given that the cook or the chef is already playing with his knives, let me go immediately into it. I cannot cover every subject into full detail. I have 30 minutes. But I'm doing a workshop on AI later on, and I'm around for the whole conference, so if you have questions, you can always approach me. I'll try to have some time for Q&A at the end. So this is what I already explained. Digital disruption is everywhere. The business models are quite new, but what digital does, or the business models are not quite new, they are basically the same as the ones we knew, is it makes into a winner-takes-all game. The disruptions are really serious, and there is a new set of challenges coming on. And at the end, my point is that many businesses will go back to craftsmanship in the IT area to basically master it all. I would like you to remember a couple of basic facts. Moore's law, the capacity per square millimeter or per dollar of transistors doubles every 18 months. It's been there for another 30 years. Today, they are almost at the atomic level. It's expected to be there for another at least 10 years. So in my career, the performance of computers went up for the same dollar by a factor 100,000. Memory was even bigger. I remember 30 years ago, somebody bought a hard disk for a VAX computer, $75,000. Today, I buy 4 terabytes at MediaMarkt for my home server at roughly less than $100. Networking capacity, bandwidth, this is not even taking into account 5G, times 300,000. I want to make one footnote. I remember as a student booting MS-DOS. It was one floppy disk. Who doesn't know what a floppy disk is in this room? Okay, yeah. So today, Windows 10 is about 33 gigabytes, not counting the updates. And actually, whatever you have in the background of your systems is devouring about a third to two-thirds of that performance improvement. But that's my own personal footnote. But this technology acceleration is the main reason why AI is back in fashion today. This is the reason why an Amazon can really drive stuff. This is the reason why Google can be the uniformal search engine. And this is the reason why we know the digital disruption that we see in every business represented in this room today. Just to give you a couple of examples. Everybody talks about Uber. Everybody knows what a taxi was. Everybody talks about Airbnb. When I was a young man, I used to have a paper book called Logis de France, which was exactly the same stuff, but it was paper-based and you needed to make phone calls. The same is true for Amazon and a library, and even Netflix and what RTL did in Luxembourg 15 years ago is roughly the same. The difference is the power of software. Netflix brings software to bear and content which is unsurpassable by any of the incumbents. And why is this possible? Because of advances in software technology, because of advances in computing power, and because of the power of the internet. So what happens? Yellow Pages, everybody remembers them. In my country, they went bankrupt. Is there any country where they are a thriving business? Please raise your arms. Okay, you've given the answer. If you look at travel agencies, apart from niche segments, they've severely reduced. And this is, by the way, happening all over High Street. I look at fashion shops, I look at many retailers, they're all in trouble because they've invested in capacity of bricks and mortars, and it's very tough for them to give a full digital answer. I'm a big music buff. There used to be records stores. Right now, they're the equivalent, because I know vinyl is back and big time, and I'm very happy I kept all my vinyl, cherished. But it's a bit like antiques, right? It's a hobbyism. And surprisingly, there are a couple of sectors that are doing quite well. Just as a fact, the number of hairdressers in Western Europe has doubled in the last 5 years. It's still, until robotics is far enough, pretty difficult to give you a digital haircut. And one thing that is quite good is that radio is flourishing. And I think it has to do with something like cars. People like to listen to the radio in their car for traffic information or news, whatever. But that is doing rather well. But so this disruption is very serious. And I think you all know that. What we've experienced as a bank, and whether you're in pharmaceuticals, semiconductors, consumer goods, I think you've experienced the same. Some companies raised the bar for all of us. Apple made it simple. Go to your room, you have a TV in there, take the remote control, take a look at it, look at your iPhone, your iPod, whatever it is you have. The remote control is a design of the 70s done by smart engineers and ununderstandable by 99% of the world population. Apple is intuitive. But consumers say, I want you as a business to be as simple as Apple. Google is ubiquitous. Consumers say, I want you to be as ubiquitous as Google. Airbnb offers you millions of choices. Consumers say, if I want to travel to Barcelona or Miami, I want to see it all. The bar is dramatically raising. When I started my career in banking, there were about 3 million checks by means of statements per month on accounts. Today, in ING, we have 11 million mobile app users who check their balance on average 10 times per day. So this means that our computing power, our 24/7 availability, our cybersecurity needs to dramatically increase to meet up with these consumer expectations. So a lot of books are around. Everybody knows, I think, Harari. He wrote 3 books by now, A Short History of Mankind, Homo Deus, and a new one. Some of these ideas are pretty intriguing. Not all of them are equally good. Thomas Friedman wrote a book about technology progress. Thomas Friedman actually is a columnist who loves to comment about culture. So if he writes about technology, it must be serious. But what I recommend to all of you is the book of an Oxford professor called Nick Bostrom, called Superintelligence, who basically thinks through what could happen if computing power continues to increase and algorithmic power tends to go up. It's quite fascinating. It's not an easy read. On the cover you will see Loved by Bill Gates. I think Bill Gates is a very smart man. It's not an easy read, but it's worthwhile to try and read it through. But my main point is the following. What we see come together is the internet really brought communications to all of us. 50 billion connected devices. Sensors are even going further. The average, let's say, good car these days has about 250 sensors. Yeah, that's a car. And dramatic advances in mathematics have increased the power of algorithms. If you want to know where the most sophisticated algorithms comes from, go to Berkeley. Astronomy has produced some of the most difficult, they're publicly published, but profound algorithms in terms of search, anomaly detection, and so on. Things you have to do, all of you in your business, and what you need to understand is you have to transport the capability horizontally, whether I'm in banking, or in astronomy, or in consumer goods, to see that the algorithm does exactly the same thing. It just so happens that the context is different. But you can multiply this stuff. And if you multiply this stuff, and you say that's the impact, I think we've not even seen the tip of the iceberg. We've seen an ice molecule. AI is getting back into fashion. When I was an engineering student, it's 30 years ago, the hottest topic in town was Lisp and Prolog. Everybody knows what Lisp and Prolog is? Yeah? So they were extremely hot. You needed special processors for that. It was so horrible to do, but it was very promising. Today, all that is much more simple. Why? Because of the technological progress. If you have about, for the same amount of money, a billion times more memory, if your processing power is a million times faster, you can do stuff. And if you have the algorithms, which, by the way, you can find on the website of Berkeley University, you can do a lot more stuff than you could ever do before. And this is what drives forward the power. I give you one example. Who in this room has studied linear algebra? Please raise your hand. First year of thing. Oh, the majority. Anybody remembers what an eigenvector is? This is a bit tougher. Please have a sip of wine. Try again. Okay, but eigenvector are pretty simple things in matrix theory. If you reduce a matrix by transformation, so that the only numbers which are non-zero are on the diagonal, right? That's what an eigenvector is. Google works with eigenvectors. Google is a very sophisticated application of eigenvectors, nothing more. And they do it on language. They have figured out that if you put words into a huge matrix, which is millions on rows on millions of columns, you can actually number questions in such a way that they almost end up on the diagonal. That's how you get 12.8 million results in less than 1 second. And indeed, if you ask concepts that are not related according to the eigenvector theory, you get rubbish. This is the explanation for my friend Adam. Where is he? I don't know where he is, but now you know why your experiment didn't work. But there's a dramatic amount of new knowledge being developed, and people are a bit different about it. Google and Amazon keep everything private. Microsoft publishes everything. And it's quite amazing if you see, for example, if you take LinkedIn, the relationship between how much messages that you get from LinkedIn and what you do is actually totally controlled by artificial intelligence. They figured out that if you give too much response, people are shied away because they get too much coming at them. And if you don't give enough response, people actually don't come back because they didn't find anything worthwhile. So to optimize that type of stuff, they have discovered a continuous measurement with an artificial intelligence algorithm that is basically always testing the optimum. Now, I talk a little bit more in the workshop on what's behind this, neural networks, adapting type of algorithms. But basically, I want to make here the following important point. If you think about knowledge or intelligence, there are 5 levels I distinguish. It's a bit, you know, a Maslow pyramid. It's my own. But you have data, information, knowledge, insights, and wisdom. Now, everybody talks about this, but what do they really mean? So I give you a little bit of an example. You know, data is something like the temperature. You can always measure it. Information is something like, okay, it's freezing, rain is coming, it might be snowfall. It's not because it's freezing, it's snow, but under certain conditions it is. Then you say, all right, if I know that, and I'm a bit a smart person, I can determine skiing conditions. One level higher up is, okay, if I know all this, maybe I can do some smart infrastructure planning. And then wisdom comes into play when you say, okay, I want to do all that, but I want to preserve nature. How do I do that? And what I see today is that artificial intelligence doesn't get higher up than the knowledge level. And I don't know how much it contradicts your super PhD presentation that you translated into plain vanilla English, hopefully from Brooklyn and not from Shakespeare. But I think it must get pretty close because it's quite honestly, it's a universally accepted fact. What does this mean? It means that, I mean, everybody talks about artificial intelligence will eliminate 70% of all current white-collar jobs. That might even be true. But there will be other jobs that are there. And the true challenge is not to find these other jobs, because I'm pretty sure collectively we could come up with 500 new jobs in 20 minutes that will be created. The problem is how to create education to fill these jobs. Because most of us start with understanding data, distilling information, assuming some knowledge, and then go to some insights. And what we need to learn, and it's one of our biggest challenges as society, is how to educate people so that they become, at the insight level, about 10 times as fast as they do today in the education system. And if we can do that, then there are tons of problems we can solve in healthcare, in finance, in environmental control, you name it. But it's quite important that we understand that that is the challenge that will be presented to us when we move forward. There are a couple of things that frighten me about AI. And let me give you the following example. We humans are intelligent. And some of us do not behave very correctly. And what society has done in the last 10,000 years is developed sophisticated mechanisms, and they do not always work that well, to try and corral incorrect behavior. And we don't have that for computers. I give you a couple of examples. Education, okay. The equivalent in computer science is data feed or reward functions in reinforced learning. And we, for example, we use in the bank Watson, which is the IBM artificial intelligence solutions, to screen CVs. Because Watson doesn't get tired, Watson doesn't have to pick up the phone, and Watson works 24/7. And it's much better than any recruiter screening CVs. Most recruiters would tell you they get bored by screening CVs. Interviewing is a lot more fun, especially if the interviewers, interviewees, have been selected and be really great people. Social interaction is another powerful mechanism to keep irrational behavior under control. Social pressure, reactions on the social media. And the equivalent that we use in computer science is model testing. Just to give you a little bit of a fact, at ING we hold 50 billion euros of capital as a risk provision. 1 billion of that, that's an awful lot of money, is being reserved for model risk. Meaning the models that are best and are brightest produce, somewhere go wrong, will produce some form of mistake, need correction, and for that we have 1 billion in capital. And if you look at the most successful venture capital company in the world, anybody has an idea who it is? Just a little hint, it's on the right, the second bullet, is Renaissance Capital. Renaissance Capital was formed by a math PhD. It's a closed fund, meaning it doesn't want to become very big. It has produced in 30 years, a year on year, including Lehman Brothers crisis and everybody else, 40% return on equity. And how does it do that? First of all, you cannot apply there if you're a banker. You must be an astrophysicist, a biologist, a geneticist, or whatever. So people must come from other fields. And second, and this is the golden rule of any arbitrage, Renaissance understands if it wants to beat the market by using inefficiencies, it has to remain small. Because otherwise it's becoming the market. And then others will use their inefficiencies against them. And the last one is policing. And we all know the value of policing. And the best form of policing is when people are very friendly and they never need to intervene. But nobody would want a society without police. And just to give you a fact, Facebook today employs 7,000 people that just eliminate content from Facebook, which is honestly not to be seen. I mean, people do extremely weird things, and maybe not many people, but if you have 1.8 billion users, even if 0.01% of your users are a bit funny, you still have 1.8 million users that create content that you don't want to be seen. So 7,000 people in Facebook. The bad news is that this digital world is a winner-takes-all world. What you see here is sort of a diagram, and the size of the squares is about proportionate to the stock market value. The chart is a bit old, but still valid. It's Apple, it's Amazon, it's Facebook, it's Google. And if you look at a few of the historically big names, like GE and so on, they're all going or gone. There's still quite a few banks up there. Bank of America, Citigroup is there, Berkshire Hathaway, Warren Buffett's company is there. But all of the old industrial 500 names, maybe with the exception of Johnson & Johnson, they're all gone. It's the tech companies that rule the world. The analysts have figured it out. Software eats the world. And it's a winner-takes-all game, because if you get it right, digital scales really well. So what are a couple of examples? The first thing I want to point out, if you look at the success of Google and what Google makes Google really great, friends, it's not the software. It's the operation. They run their data centers better than anybody else. They put fiber in the ocean between San Francisco and Santiago de Chile, 16,000 kilometers of it, to reduce response time. They make their own servers. None of us in this room can buy them. They're better than anything we can buy. Excuse me, chief sponsor. But they're really better because they need so many of them, they said, and they're so important to their well-being, we're going to design our own. So they have redefined operations completely. And I tell you one thing, in a world that is 24/7, where consumers are extremely demanding, operations do matter. And it was for a while, it was a bit out of fashion, and you say, okay, let's put everything in the cloud, and all that will happen. But the moment your shop is down, you're dead. And that will increasingly become the paradigm that we have to live in. Consequent number two, life becomes a bit more dramatically volatile. And this is the number of years that the company was the most valuable company, and GE holds that record for 13 years, as you've seen. They reduced their dividend now to 1 cent, and it becomes a lot more volatile. Eh? So now it's Amazon, Apple, and so on. So, but the speed of innovation is such that positions change very rapidly, very quickly. Lessons number three, a lot of people die. These are some of the most illustrious names. I remember as a young engineer, went to Finland. I saw Nokia, the first GSM phone. At some point in time, Nokia's market cap was half the Finnish economy. And today, it is still quite a good network company, but the handset was something that they clearly struggled with. And you see, so anybody remembers MySpace? Yeah? Where is it now? Yeah? I remember people saying, this is going to be the next economy. We're going to make our total life there. I think you can buy it today if you want for $250,000. So if tomorrow at the charity auction we all do our best, we can buy MySpace. I want to point out something else. Who knows Aladdin in this room? Aladdin is the research service that is provided by BlackRock. BlackRock is the biggest asset manager in the world. It manages $9 trillion of other people's money. And you can buy Aladdin as a research services. About $20 trillion, it was $9 trillion, by the way, not billion. $20 trillion of asset managers do so. They say, I think BlackRock is the best. They follow the research of BlackRock. And what you get is actually a dangerous case of lemming behavior. Everybody believes the same thing. Now, I'm not saying Aladdin is bad. Probably Aladdin is the best you can get. But if it gets wrong, everybody follows it. It increases volatility, it reduces price discovery, and it's one of the reasons that we see so volatile stock markets today, despite reasonably favorable economic conditions in many countries. So this is a new fact. If everybody goes digital, if everybody has the same tools, if everybody has the same algorithms, we all will make the same mistakes. And society has become powerful because of mistakes were isolated to subgroups or to smaller communities. And this is very big danger. And there are more fundamental changes. I'll be very quick. We need to evolve our ethics. Everybody knows about Russian involvement in elections. But even more profound, our biology might be changing. Your children learn how to swipe at the age of 18 months. This means that the neurons link differently. This means that as teenagers, they will have different capabilities. I think it's quite important to at least realize that that will be happening, to figure out how to best guide our children to become the citizens within 20 years that will lead the world just like we need to lead it today. And then truth becomes elusive. It has always been a little bit elusive because, for example, election manipulation was also done by the Romans and so on. The most important thing is that now you can do it stealthily. And that it's easier to mobilize 1 million servers than it is to bribe 1 million voters. So the impact of all this becomes a bit more daunting. And then digitization is really impacting to our society to the degree that I believe there used to be a distinction between rich countries and poor countries. And today I think that is a bit blurred. I think today it's much more between rich citizens or smart citizens and poor citizens or not so educated citizens. And I think the divide is becoming totally different. And this has implications for everybody in this room because all of us live in a certain country and we need to think through what it means. My point is basically we need more innovative thinking. We need more systemic thinking. Often when we introduce technology, we see the first order effect. It's much better or faster to, let's say, buy goods, but we forget second order effects. The best example I can give to you, in the latest version of the Apple operating system, it tells you how long you have been looking at your screen. Because there is emerging evidence that it might not be too good to watch your screen for 10 or 12 hours a day. So you see how these things need to adapt. And also, we need to rethink our ethical thinking. I gave you some examples on risk and policing and artificial intelligence. And more important, the long-term impact on the environment is very difficult to forecast. It might not be bad, might even be much better than what we think, but we need to start understanding it. So this is the journey that we did at ING to come and take terms of this. We understood, and I think there's quite an important point I need to make, that in this new era of powerful IT, we needed to go back to craftsmanship. So when I was studying, IT was done in a separate department, separate building. Men wore a white coat, and they were feeding mainframes. And then IT went through a whole era where it became sort of like car production. All of us remember, you know, the user had a wish, there were user requirements, technical requirements, functional requirements. Somewhere in the middle, somebody wrote some code, then it was tested functionally, technical, and so on. And at the end, we had some working software. And this was like assembling a car. Everybody had their task, and at the end, you got a car that came out. Today, IT works like the surgical team. The surgeon that operates with a laser and has these endoscopic instruments and intervenes with a patient. And it's in a small team, and everybody knows exactly what they're doing. The anesthetist, the surgeon, the nurse, and so on. And we went back to that model. In a long journey, we introduced DevOps. We introduced automated deployments. We actually mimicked what Amazon was doing with web services. And then at the end, we redefined the professional IT engineering profile of our people. Because we realized that people made much more impact than they did before. Developers are the rock stars today. They really make a difference. If you look at the success stories, Netflix, Spotify, and so on, there's only a handful of developers that really drive these fantastic pieces of software forward. And this is how we copied, actually, the Spotify model and went into global tribes. That's what we've done, actually, the beginning of last year. So we took like a 7-year journey to try and adapt as an organization in our IT culture, and I skip a lot of details for time's sake, but this is actually what we've done. For our IT engineers, the model used to be quite simple. We had an HR framework. If you wanted to get promoted, at some point you got a manager. You became even a senior manager, a super manager. Some of your best technical people, some of your best DevOps engineers that you need to fight Google, some of your best developers, they don't like to manage. They're even not good at it. And they're fantastic engineers. So we needed to break that. So we introduced a model. It's called the Dreyfus model. And it's based on two professors at Massachusetts Institute of Technology who observed behavior in engineers. And basically, we now work with 5 levels, which is like an apprenticeship. You start as a novice. Basically come from university, you start to work, you become what is called advanced, you know some stuff, until you reach the competent level. And a competent level, a competent engineer is somebody who can take a problem and solve it autonomously. And then it goes higher up, and these are the most interesting levels. Then you have the proficient and the expert level. Proficient people are people where junior people go to and say, I don't know how to solve this. Can you help me? And they are recognized for being broader than what their job content is. Experts are even better. They speak at DEF CON in Silicon Valley, or they are recognized as thought leaders in their field. Java programming, detailed operations, monitoring, cybersecurity, you name it. And these people, if you have such people, let them be expert. Don't make them a manager and give them line responsibility over 200 others. They hate it. They want to push the boundary. They don't want to manage 200 other people. This is what we realized and what we introduced. And that leads to quite some external competition. I have some examples here of people. But it leads me, and this is something I even showed to the European Central Bank, which is the supervisor of ING and many other banks, to the belief that in this new world where technology is dramatically important, you could ask the question whether engineers will not be the bankers of the future. Those were my remarks. Thank you.